gentlemen. Forgive the state of our dress. Dr. DeVoe, Zen and myself were somewhat inconvenienced by a mob. Rest assured, though, none of them were former patients.
Well, let's hope the authorities follow sound medical practice, eh? Best way to treat hysteria is to open a few veins.
Fellows of the Royal Society of Medicine, guests, this assembly has been called so that certain claims made by Dr. Franz Anton Mesmer of Vienna can be examined. I call upon a colleague of Dr. Mesmer's, Dr. Charles Delon, who is, of course, known to us all as an honored fellow. Doctor...
It is always difficult to judge in good faith. Any claim which seems beyond the principles that are the accepted ones of the day. When I was first approached by Dr. Mesmer, I too was skeptical, even incredulous. He began by outlining for me the theory of animal magnetism, and my skepticism increased.
I'm sure it did.
I therefore took Dr. Mesmer to see some of the afflicted. I asked him to treat them. I watched.
Where did you take him?
To the lunatic asylum.
Charlatan!
Imposter!
Experiment!
Yes, Doctor. The lunatic asylum indeed. We walked through the pillars of misery, and Dr. Mesmer wept. And then I saw Dr. Mesmer apply his art. I watched him induce, then control, then take away an epileptic seizure. I saw him make a dropsical limb swell and shrink virtually at will. I observed for myself how the patients began to understand that their own bodies were in some part their own responsibility, that many of these symptoms were not visitations from beyond, not fate, but directly due to their own experiences, memories, attitudes. The doctor was there to hold up a mirror for.
She's been blistered and administered with poison. This is the point. I'm gradually bringing these fits under control by the very methods I was describing to you.
Really?
Dr. Ingeniers, lay your hands upon her.
Fine.
I want you to see something with your own two eyes. Your hands, here.
And what is the point of this?
Stroke, sir. Both your hands. Stroke. Power could be transferred not only to you, but to other objects. Hold this against her.
No, this is all too perverse for my taste.
Forgive me, I thought you were a serious and open-minded man. I brought this girl here from an asylum.
I do know the case.
She's my cousin, Professor.
It was a kind gesture, but as a doctor, it was irresponsible. You haven't cured her. We must bleed her immediately. Open up one of her veins.
Concede that the power of the magnet may be just a hint of a similar force acting all the time on human beings.
Damn nonsense.
Surely, Dr. Ingenhouse, surely you do not deny that the silvery harlot of the night has it...
The who?
The moon, sir.
If you mean the moon, Dr. Mesmer, why on earth do you not say so?
Moon.
We are supposed to be men of science, not ranting adolescent poets.
But does it not pull the very ocean far up shore and then drag it back again? Can you see the force, or the pull of the magnet, or the electricity?
Dr. Mesmer, I am not in the slightest degree accustomed to being dressed as though I were a child. And may I remind you that superstition and religious enthusiasm have been purged from the Queen of Sciences.
Oh, I'm sorry, my passion makes me gabble.
Passion and medicine do not mix, Dr. Mesmer.
They don't?
No, they are at opposite poles. And since you choose to use the moon in your dissertation, I also remind you that it is the symbol of lunatics.
If I could only let the arrow fly.
What?
The shaft of thought, Dr. Ingenhouse. The conviction that I have made a discovery which will lift pain, misery, and disharmony from our burdened frames.
What a fool you are! What a cock-crowing idiot you turned out to be! The great genius, Mesmer. Living on his wife's charity. Only the son of a shit-assed gamekeeper.
Your language...
What?
What?
Listen, you smug. Don't I pay the bills and give you some sort of entry into better society? I've a mind to sell the house.
The house is, as you imply, yours to sell, my dear.
Sell the house and move us out. Lock, stock and barrel.
Bathtub. Lock, stock and bathtub.
Everything you say is perfectly true, my dear.
It is, yes.
For certainly I could not have married you for your generous spirit.
What?
Say as little as possible about your tact, your charm and your missing back teeth.
And you can take that ugly grin off your face.
Their Excellencies, Baron Heretzky de Horka and the Baroness de Horka. His Excellency, Chancellor Anton Menzel von Kaunitz.
Look, Franz. Good afternoon, ladies.
My pleasure. Good afternoon.
And they say he's so frightened of ailments and diseases that he will not let anyone within two arms' length of him who has so much as a spot. A little spot upon their face.
I'm sorry.
The Chancellor.
Dr. Anton Stern.
Yes.
It's unhealthy to be so obsessed with sickness.
We're the only animal that knows it's going to die, madame.
Yes.
And yet we're also the only species that has some faint sense of perfection.
Oh, dear. Philosophy.
Hence, our inner rage at sickness. We could hear the music of the heavenly spheres if only we strained to listen.
As a bat, ever since she was three.
Maria Theresa, concentrate. Concentrate, daughter.
Of Franz Anton Mesmer.
And who, pray, may that be?
I am he.
Are you aware that you're manhandling Professor Sturck?
Get out of the way.
Physician to the Empress.
What does the physician to the Empress intend to do to this young woman? Open her veins or open her eyes?
Indian House, who is this man?
I am a man. Girls, besides, sir. You should never cover such an exquisite face.
Mesmer, leave her alone!
Will someone please remove this man?
One moment, please.
Your Excellency, if I may say so.
This is no time for speech making. Let's at least see what this man can do.
If Your Excellency so wishes.
Not. Sun holds there. A magnet draws earth to itself. All is ebb and flow.
There is a universal unseen force, moving through all things and all creatures. It is this power of animal magnetism moving from me to you, Maria Theresa, that provoked the crisis.
Nonsense.
This power moving from me to you. As it encountered the distortion of your sickness. Encountered the distortion of your sickness. You can feel it. Here is your patient. She has not been harmed.
Professor Sturck, Dr. Ingenhouse, it is my profound hope that you will now care for your patient with as much diligence and conviction as you showed when objecting to the relief of her agony.
Ha!
Ah.
can hear it.
It was the door. It was that man opening and closing the door.
No, listen.
Much diligence and conviction as you showed when objecting to the relief of her agony.
Please, Dr. Ingenhaus. It hurts too much.
Then it's doing its job. As tight on your head as your own skin. And as hard as your own bone.
Isn't there another way? Perhaps Dr. Mesmer.
Are you deranged?
But he took away my daughter's pain.
Does this child's pain not come?
No.
Yes, it was. I know what that man performs. Comic opera.
Go on playing.
I don't feel like it.
Did you want to say something to me, my dearest?
Listen. Thunder. You can hear it. It always gives me a headache.
Then you should go to your bed, my dear. Angels guard you, dear wife.
Angels guard you, dear husband.
what you wish. Anything on this earth I can give. Anything.
Mesmer. Take me to Mesmer.
What are you doing? Franzel, Franzel. You know you shouldn't be out of your bed. What is it? What are you trying to say? Glad you're here. is it?
Somewhere, a long way away, I thought I heard the sweetest little song.
What song? I didn't hear a song.
I did. Da 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 da. Da da da.
My wife's young cousin has a music box at her bedside. It plays exactly that tune. The tiniest of sounds, and yet you must have heard it all the way from here. Please, we are to sit.
I can hear a dewdrop as it quivers on a spider's web. Or a fly as it walks across the ceiling. No. It cannot be so.
I cannot hear a dewdrop on a spider's web. I can see it. A diamond in a cradle of silk. What is it?
I can hear the turn of the world. I can hear the moon crossing the sky.
And can you hear the human heart? When I was a boy, I too could hear the turn of the world. I used to climb the tallest slope that I could find in order to listen better.
What did it sound like?
Like the wind in the dreams. Like the beat of a bird's wing. Clean.
Clean.
Climb as high as I could in order to get away from the dirt down below.
Yes.
The slow, spreading stain. The contamination.
Yes.
That's what you don't want to see.
You're hurting my wrist.
You shall see.
I can hear the little minuet again.
Sure.
I can. I can hear it. Like the scent of flowers, the music in the air. And it's only for me. You cannot hear it. You cannot know. You cannot.
Thank you. upset.
How did he do it? I mean, something strange happened with that blind girl last week.
Well, your stepfather is the sort of fool who doesn't know he's a fool, Franz, and sometimes God smiles upon such creatures, that's all.
Yeah, but how did he do it? I mean, something happened. Look at all that rabble
out
there.
Oh, shut up! Look what he does! Insults the best doctors and gets what for clients? Riffraff with no money. Scum without any shoes. They need a bucket of piss thrown over them.
We know that you're in there!
That means you!
I am the one you seek.
Go away, you scum!
I don't go!
Baron de Hawker. He's outside.
He was at the piano recital, wasn't he?
Yes.
Well, bid him welcome. And Franz!
Leave me alone with him for a quarter of an hour. Understand?
Yes, Mama.
This is a very big fish. My husband is without tact, or indeed sufficient sense of the social proprieties. You see, his father was a gamekeeper, and Franz Anton must have spent much of his boyhood lying on his belly in the grass. But his obvious intelligence, the originality of his mind, have taken him far beyond birds' eggs and rabbit nooses. Although perhaps leaving some sense of these lowlier matters in his manner. My own family, which is extremely distinguished, often say to me that I couldn't have made a better match.
Join her. Pick up the match. Pick up the mic. I've completed the circle. Oh, people. Pitiless world. Where shall we find the mercy and the pity and the truth? And how shall we end the abuse and the cruelty and the pain? Magnets will reinforce the power of the universal fluid. It is a force which flows through all things. It is a force which straightens out that which is bent, that which is sick, that which is crooked, stupid, that which is untrue. But as this force meets pain, pain will resist. When I touch the magnet, when I do what I alone can do, then you will feel it coursing through you. You will feel it. You will. You will.
In the circle. Storm has passed over you. Each of you has gone some little way towards harmony and health. Yourselves up.
My head is still on fire.
I can't see.
My head is still on fire.
My skin is still the same.
To look in before you can look out.
Get out.
Tom?
Husband, wake yourself up.
I want to be alone, thank you.
But Anton...
Alone.
I said.
The Baron de Hawker wishes to consult with you, my dear.
Dr. Mesmer is at your service, your esteemed excellence. What did you wish to consult me about, sir?
I think there's something not quite right with my throat.
Prego. What do you think you're doing?
Breaking my fucking back. My lady.
Insolence!
I'll ask you again. What do you think you are doing?
The master Bounces Basfield, my lady. Way up in his study.
Why?
I'm not sure.
So this is what we do, is it? Kissing, is it?
Excuse me a moment, Maria Theresa. Get out of this room.
What?
If you crash in unannounced again when I'm with a patient...
How dare you? How dare you speak to me like that in my house?
These hands. Look at them. They are the means by which I try to banish pain and misery. All things can be used for good or ill, light of my life. Interrupt me again with your vile innuendos, and I will squeeze every last drop of poison out of you. Understand? Gregor, you brought the water. Light of my life. Please leave us now. Pour it into the bath.
Yes. Is it true you have been taking your daughter to Mesmer?
She especially wanted to. Professor Stirk, Maria Theresa is a very strong-willed young woman, and...
Does not your daughter receive a pension from the Empress because of her disability?
And because of her talent, a small honorarium, sir, yes.
So small you can do without it.
Dr. Mesmer wishes me to stay, Father. He thinks it's better if I'm there all the time.
No.
Yes.
No, no, no.
I am staying there.
You are not going to stay. You are to stop seeing that man. I have already written to him. I shall not take you.
Then I shall go myself.
Sit down! Go! Maria Teresa! Maria! Maria!
Don't touch her.
Why?
Don't touch her.
Well, she can't see, can she? You don't want her to fall now, do you? Well, forgive me. I leave you in the hands of your doctor.
I wasn't expecting you. I was even beginning to wonder if you'd come at all.
Come?
Your father has written to me.
I know. My father is afraid.
He says he will not let you stay here. And, well, hints that he's not happy with the treatment.
My father is afraid.
The whole tone of the letter is negative.
My father is afraid. Can he see us from the house? Is he looking at us? Can he see me?
No, he cannot.
Let me see you.
father.
Indeed, they're not. Paradise.
Close your eyes.
What is it?
You may see. You try to shut out what you do not want to see. But it's there. You know its shape. Under this cover, beneath these folds, your eyes will seek.
And then...
as it ever was. I shall bring this whole affair to the attention of the authorities. To the attention of the authorities.
Grass is soon cut down. We who are doctors know full well what the preacher says, and it cannot but give us humility. We live in a world where sickness is the common lot, and where those who suffer can at times be so eager in their search for the alleviation of their pain that they add to the sickness of their bodies a feebleness of the brain. Gullibility, gentlemen. I speak of gullibility. The fraudulent and the deceitful, the charlatan and the impostor, these are our enemies. And such a man is even now in our midst. A man who must be rooted out. A man whom we are duty-bound to chase out of our midst. I refer to one, Franz Anton Mesmer.
On the seventh day, no rest for us, little one. I'm going to take off the bandage, Maria Theresa.
I'm frightened.
Listen to me, listen to me. There are now just a few strands of silk between the perpetual night of your life up until this moment and the first shimmer and dance of the light that from now on will always be yours. Believe in me.
I do. Darkness.
What is to be is to be.
No, no, no! What is to be is not out of our hands. Moment by moment, we make our own lives. It is the old order, the old way, the old cruelty which denies us this right.
It is in the cauldron of the very next minute that we decide our fates. Not yesterday, not some tomorrow, but always, forever, now. How else but in the very next minute are we to be free? What is this? What is it? Is there light? Are there shapes?
Ah, but the shape of a petal astonishes me, too.
You cannot know the true wonder of it. Who would have known that a cloud would be like it is? Oh, the world is alive, with gleams like notes in music.
And the pains in your head, have they gone? Have they completely cleared away?
Yes, yes. Now my head sings instead.
Before I met you.
deepest sympathies. It must be intolerable for you.
Well, stop them.
The young lady must not be over-distressed. That was our agreement with Mr. Paradis.
Mr. Paradis is waiting with the carriage.
I'll go.
Look at me.
Take me home.
Most derangements, sir. Day of infamy and of outrage which will long be remembered.
No, sir. It's a Tuesday which soon will be forgotten. It's time for us to part. You know the orders. Keep your feet out of the city.
Thank you.
why do you seek to interest us in nervous agitations? Don't we have enough agitations everywhere? Who is this fellow Mesmer, anyway? Where does he come from?
Vienna.
Ah, Marie Antoinette.
Dr. Delong believes him to be
Doctors
a man...
Doctors who speak in German invariably assume their patients suffer from constipation. Our nerves are calm. We are at ease. Nervous agitations. The best cure for that is a bullet, not a German doctor.
Look at this. What's the matter for?
This man, Mesmer, is it true that he has cured a young woman of her blindness in his native Vienna?
It is, madam.
And is it true that he can cure dropsy and paralytic fits?
I have seen it myself, my lady.
Really?
Is he able to restore the appetite?
I have no doubt that Dr. Mesmer can revivify the pleasures of the table, my lady.
Oh, I refer to the pleasure of the... monsieur.
Can you do anything about my back?
Your back, Duchess.
It hurts, you see. Especially... well, at certain times, Doctor.
At night?
Certain nights.
And when you are... what, not alone in your bed?
Oh, you are the first doctor ever to understand.
Milady, your nerves... are out of alignment. If, help me, if your husband could just...
I was not talking about my husband, sir.
I'm sorry. The diagnosis remains the same, whatever the shape or size of the member. You see before you the conductors of my power. Don't be frightened if you swoon away. Don't resist. Let it caress you, whisper to you, murmur to you as the force in me comes flowing into your flesh, your nerves, your bones. Take hold. Hold the rope. You may perhaps lose control of your senses. Let it fight the pain.
your body is now a battlefield. Can the light win? Will it? Will it?
Will it?
The fight from my hands to you as it contends with your ailments, untangles your nerves, staples the obstacles.
Ladies with small diseases, and every silver-spooned hysteric in Paris.
I cure the sick, Charles, because I can reach into their souls. This is just play acting.
Not anymore. The Royal Society has set a date for the hearing.
They're not interested in my theories. They just want to make me look a fool. One day we shall all come to acknowledge that our emotions and our bodies are not separate without the blessing of the Royal Society. What's happening?
Paris, the capital of reason. And half-digested ideas come back up like vomit.
Liberty is not a thing the poor half-digest, Charles. They swallow it whole, especially when there's nothing else to eat.
Franz Anton.
When a society is sick, all its members are ill too. Including us. Look out, but they can also look in.
Understand that their own bodies were in some part their own responsibility, that many of these symptoms were not visitations from beyond, not fate, but directly due to their own experiences, memories, attitudes. The doctor was there to hold up a mirror for them. I have heard, endlessly, the objection that all the cures that I have exhaustively enumerated rely upon the workings of the patient's own imagination. But what of that? What if they do? If Dr. Mesmer's secret is that he engages the imagination and makes it work in the cause of mental and physical harmony, then is not this alone? This in itself, a wonderful advance in medicine.
I have considered what I have to say at great length and with great care. I owe it to our guest and to the society to be absolutely precise in what I say. Franz Anton Mesmer, you are a charlatan. There is no such thing as animal magnetism, and it therefore cannot have cured a single living soul. Each and every one of these cures, so-called, turns out, upon properly rigorous examination, to be, and I truly regret to say it, downright fraud. Indeed, I took the opportunity to question one such patient. A lady of distinction. One who allegedly was cured of her deafness. And I asked her, are you truly better? And do you know what she replied? What did you say? Our colleagues in the medical faculty of Vienna will be surprised at none of this. The only thing that would cause them astonishment is the length of time it has taken the savants of Paris to discover the truth. Welcome, Professor Sturken Ingenhardt.
Gentlemen, I would like on your behalf to extend to our visitors the gratitude of the Royal Society of Medicine for the effort and grace they have expended. Professor Sturk, welcome. You have our profound attention.
I thank you, Monsieur Vic d'Azur, and you, Monsieur Roussel de Vozem, for the privilege you have granted me in allowing me to continue here in Paris my lifelong fight to extirpate error, superstition, ignorance, and fraud from the fair science of fact. Against the express wishes of her father, was subjected to this charlatanism of which you have heard. I took the liberty of bringing this young lady with me. And I will ask her now to lift her veil.
Maria Theresa, Professor Sturk has asked you to lift your veil.
No matter. One simple question will suffice. Maria Teresa Paradis, can you see?
Gentlemen, I do not wish to alarm you unduly.
Silence!
Gentlemen, I think you should know you are in the veriest danger of losing your lives.
Oh, no.
Did you know?
I don't know how I knew.
You abandoned me. I cannot see.
Do you want to see?
No. I would rather not see what there is to see. When I could see the notes on the piano, I made mistakes. I could not bear to lose that one thing. My music. One pure, clean thing.
I wish I didn't know what you mean. But I do. When I was a boy, I would climb the mountain. And I could see that all around me, from one horizon to the other, everything was in harmony, in balance. Except human beings. Except us. And I want. I could not bear. Do nothing about it.